The hours after that mob began storming the Capitol, we finally heard from the president in a video message he tweeted to his supporters late this afternoon. We're only going to play a portion of it, though, right now. Let's take a listen.
I know your pain. I know you're hurt. We had an election that was stolen from us. It was a landslide election, and everyone knows it, especially the other side. But you have to go home now. We have to have peace. So go home. We love you. You're very special.
Okay, we heard the president right there. That video message was taken down by Facebook. It was flagged by Twitter, also taken down by YouTube. It starts with a lie that the election was stolen from President Trump. We know that's not true. The courts have said that's not true. Joe Biden clearly won this election. I want to bring in our chief White House correspondent, Jonathan Carl. John, you know, you and I have both covered President Trump. I covered the campaign. You covered him in the White House and during the campaign. Can you think of a worse day in his presidency, or was today the worst day of his presidency?
I mean, there is some competition for that, Tom, but I think this is the worst day of his presidency. I also think I was standing right here on the day that he had the protesters cleared out of Lafayette Park, and he walked right across here over to St. John's Church and raised that Bible, not reading it, not opening it. So there have been some dark days, Charlottesville. We've had some dark days of the Trump presidency, but this may well be the darkest. To see him effectively encourage that mob to march up Pennsylvania Avenue and to storm the Capitol and then to sit passively while they pushed past Capitol Police and marauded their way through the symbol and the central location of American democracy. That's one of the lowest days, not just of this presidency, but perhaps of any presidency.
You know, John, it was interesting. He spoke about American carnage and how it was going to end during his inauguration, not far from where all of this happened today. He does have a message of law and order. And I was making the point that when you cover the president long enough, things just don't surprise you. But it did surprise me today that he didn't react faster, that people like Kellyanne Conway, Senators Marco Rubio, Governor Chris Christie, all these people, his former chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney, all these people had to reach out to him, essentially begging him to sort of tell the protesters not only to stop, but to leave Capitol Hill. Do we have any idea what the mindset was, what the calculation was to let his supporters just to run rampant through Capitol Hill?
It's simply a matter of one standard for people who support him and who praise him, and another standard for everyone else. You remember during the civil unrest and the protests surrounding the George Floyd killing earlier of last summer, the president repeated that awful phrase from the civil rights movement: when the looting starts, the shooting starts. You can imagine if these were not Trump supporters who were doing this, who were not pushing past police lines and breaking into the U.S. Capitol, that he would have called, for the military to go in to forcefully clear these people out. And instead, you know, he was looking out and he saw that these were people that were carrying Trump flags. I mean, one thing that struck me watching this stuff unfold today was you did see people carrying American flags, but you saw far more people carrying Trump flags. This was not a protest movement or a political movement. This looked more like a cult of one person. They were there for Trump. They weren't there for even an ideology or for a set of political beliefs. They were there for one person. And that was the insignia they were carrying. Those were the flags they were carrying. And I think he saw that, and his instinct is, if you like him, if you say nice things about him, you know this, he thinks you're all right.
Loyalty above all. John, my final question, what are we going to see happen in 12 days? Will Vice President-elect Joe Biden, will he stand on the same stage as President Trump? Are we going to see a peaceful transfer of power?
We will see a peaceful transfer of power, I firmly believe. But I also believe there is 0% chance that we will see Donald Trump and Joe Biden together on the 20th of January, which is really something, because the transfer of power from an outgoing president to an incoming president is really the crown jewel of American democracy. And we have seen it in every after every election. we have seen that happen. Now, we have seen a handful of times, and to give you an idea, you have to go back to John Adams leaving the night before Thomas Jefferson was sworn in, or Andrew Johnson, who had been impeached, leaving before Ulysses S. Grant came in. But you, this is not something that happens. I mean, we have seen for well over a century, we have seen the presidents ingoing and outgoing, no matter how hard fought the campaign was, coming together on the day of the inauguration and being there to take part in this peaceful transfer of power. But there will be a peaceful transfer of power. Joe Biden will be sworn in on January 20th. I just don't believe there's any chance that Donald Trump will be there for it.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.